Welcome to Chit Chat, the talk show that takes on today's controversial topics in not only your neighborhood, but also neighborhoods around the world. I'm Carol Conley, and we are here today to talk about the science and controversy of vaccines with our guest, Dr. Amy Ashton and Mr. Josh Jenkins. To begin, let's have each of you give us a little information regarding your background and interest in the topic. Dr. Ashton, why don't you start?
Thank you, Carol. I have education in both physics and medicine, as well as hold degrees from the University of Chicago, including a PhD and MD. I am also the mother of two children currently living in New York. My family and I recently returned to the United States after spending 6 months with an NGO healthcare group in Angola.
Thank you, Dr. Ashton. Mr. Jenkins?
I've worked as a model and an actor. I'm a parent with one son. I've been active in the anti-vaccine movement for the past 5 years. I currently live in the state of California. I've given many presentations on the topic of vaccine side effects and vaccine compliance around my home state as well as around the country.
Well, thank you for that information and welcome to the show. Today's topic is the vaccine controversy, which is back in the public eye after the 2014-2015 Disneyland outbreak of measles infection. The fallout includes a new law passed in California regarding vaccine requirements. California Senate Bill 277 no longer allows personal exemptions for required vaccines if children are enrolled in either a public or private school or daycare. Could each of you give us your take on the controversy? Why don't you start, Dr. Ashton?
In my opinion, and from what I know of the science, parents shouldn't fear vaccinating their children because vaccine value as a public health initiative has been demonstrated via application of the scientific method.
Mr. Jenkins, could you weigh on the topic?
I don't know much about hypothesis testing, but in my own personal experience, through talking with various individuals, reading posts on Facebook and Twitter, and reading various blogs on the internet, I've come across evidence that some vaccines do more harm than good.
Josh, can you cite some scientific evidence in the scientific literature or describe research that supports your conclusions?
Well, I think it's best to cite my own personal experience. My son was diagnosed with autism shortly after he received his first MMR vaccination. Now, this evidence, combined with information that I read that states vaccines contain mercury compounds that have something called thimerosal that could cause brain damage, convinces me that vaccines are problematic and that children should not be required to receive them if the parents want to opt out.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear about your son's diagnosis.
I too am sorry and hope you've been able to access some of the programs available to families of autistic children.
Well, thank you for your empathy, but since my son's diagnosis, we've had him on a remarkable nutritional regimen, and that, combined with his physical therapy and counseling, have completely eliminated his autistic behaviors. It's been a remarkable cure.
That is very interesting, and since he received his first dose of the MMR vaccine, he may have some protection against the measles, mumps, and rubella viruses.
That may be true, but I'm not worried about measles, mumps, and rubella compromising my son's health. Measles only causes a rash, as does rubella, and I had mumps as a kid. And as I remember, other than having a swollen neck and being very tired, it was no big deal. So given the limited to non-existent risk to children in the U.S., I believe it is important that parents be the ones to decide whether their children need vaccination.
Actually, data shows that in 2014, approximately 115,000 people died from measles around the world, mostly children under the age of 5, so it can be a very serious disease. Also, the rubella virus can pose a grave health threat to the fetuses of pregnant mothers. Having spent the last 6 months in Angola treating children with measles, I am very familiar with the numbers and statistics of children becoming ill and dying from measles. In 2014, over 12,000 children were diagnosed with measles just in Angola, which is a very small country.
Well, if those numbers are accurate, that's very interesting information, but I've never heard of a child dying of measles in the U.S., so I don't think we need to be concerned.
The ease and speed of worldwide travel puts us all at risk. However, broad vaccine coverage can provide herd or community immunity. If the majority of a population is vaccinated against a certain disease, then there are no hosts for the virus or bacterium to infect.
Seems to be a bit of mumbo jumbo, Dr. Ashton. But I've known several parents who refused MMR vaccinations for their children, and yet their kids have never had measles.
Precisely. You've hit on some data that supports my hypothesis regarding herd immunity. If herd immunity is in place for the MMR, then most unvaccinated children will benefit from the small number of susceptible hosts by not becoming infected by the measles, mumps, or rubella viruses.
That is something to think about. Although Dr. Ashton hasn't given me any reason to change my beliefs, I will post this information on Facebook and Twitter and see what kind of response I get from my followers. Their feedback will help me decide whether I want to reconsider my position on vaccine compliance.
And on that note, we will bring this discussion to a close. Thank you to our guests, Amy and Josh, who both spoke eloquently on the topic. After hearing these two sides of the discussion, I urge listeners to become better informed on the topic to make the right decisions for their families and communities. I invite the audience to join us again tomorrow, where we will be talking about the use of magnets to treat arthritis, circulatory issues, and inflammation. Have a good day, everyone.